Welcome to part 3 of module 1. Here we're focusing on how to identify the mathematical content that will be used within intensive intervention and how are you going to sequence this content. This is really an extension of module 1, part 2. So here I want you to be able to identify the mathematical content that you're going to use in intensive intervention and then be able to sequence that in a meaningful way for students. So where are we on the DBI diagram? Here's our diagram. And right now we're really focusing on the orange parts of the diagram. That's where the intervention is occurring. So I want to think of like what content needs to occur within this intervention. And that's really important to establish before you choose interventions and before you start doing anything. Got to really think about the mathematical content. So that's what we're going to think about here. Now, when I'm thinking about the mathematical content for intensive intervention, I really want to focus on what's going to go into the instructional platform. And there's several things that you need to do to think about this in terms of the individual student that you're working with. So the first thing that's really helpful to do, and on my DBI diagram, I would say that this almost occurs above the DBI diagram. This occurs before you start this. So to figure out what you need to do here, you need to do some of the stuff that we're going to talk about right now. One of the things that's really helpful to do is to conduct a diagnostic assessment. So a diagnostic assessment, and you'll see this in the following module, is data that's gathered before or during learning that's going to tell us about the student's strengths and weaknesses. Now, a good diagnostic measures the student's understanding of math in multiple areas, and it provides you a good score profile or good detail about what the student knows and what the student doesn't know. Now, why it's helpful to do a diagnostic assessment up here, now you'll see it listed here, and that's going to help inform the adaptation, but I would say that before you start DBI, do a diagnostic so that you can figure out what mathematical content do I need to focus on, and what mathematical content does the student already have a good understanding of? In the same way, before starting DBI, this can be kind of up here, you can also use formative assessment data that you've gathered. Now we see formative assessment here on the DBI diagram and here, but you might have already been doing some progress monitoring in order to understand who needs to use the DBI framework. And so this is data that's gathered during intervention. You might have gathered computation scores or concepts and application scores. You might have gathered some scores related to single skill measures. And you can use that information to also inform what mathematical content do I need to teach within the intervention. You could also use summative assessment data. Perhaps you're working with a fourth grade student and you've got their end of third grade high stakes assessment data. You can use that to figure out the mathematical content that needs to go into the intensive intervention. You could also use more informal methods for figuring out what mathematical content needs to go into the intervention. For example, an error analysis. I've got this problem here, and maybe a student solves this problem. Let's see, I solve it here. I could do something really funky today. I could solve this problem like that. I don't know if many students would solve the problem like this, but if they did, I could see that the student has a stronger understanding of addition. So they know 7 plus 3 is 10, 4 plus 7 is 11, and 5 plus 6 is 11, but they have no understanding of the process of what it means to regroup. So they have a difficult time with the notation. So this error analysis could help inform the content of the instruction. I could say, wow, I really need to work on place value understanding and the understanding of regrouping in a way that I might not need to do for other students. And I'm going to clean that off there because then we'll go to our next slide. And you could also use the standards. So we talked about this in the previous part of this module. But remember, we have this continuum of mathematics learning. And when I'm thinking about what's going to go into this intervention program, I can look at the standards and say, well, my student needs to be here, but they're here, so I could use the standards to also guide the content of the intensive intervention. So I want you to think about all of these things. So using diagnostic assessments, using formative assessments, using summative assessments, using error analysis, and reflecting upon your standards to look at this activity number 5. So I want you to look at this set of word problems here. And I want you to add, like, this is 2 pages. This comes from an intervention for third grade students. And I want you to figure out what foundational skills do students need to know in order to solve these problems. So I'd actually like to read the problems, and many times it's helpful to solve these problems. So what did you do as you were solving these problems? What knowledge did you need? And then I want you to answer, what types of assessments could you use to design the mathematical content for intensive intervention if you were teaching problems like these? So we're focusing on this continuum of math learning and thinking about what is the content that I need to focus on within intensive intervention. Because I want students to be here, but my student is here. And remember, you're using that DBI to hopefully move students from here to here. And we can use data, so the data that we collect from different types of assessments and the standards, to appropriately sequence the instructional content. So if I need to be here and I'm here, I can use that data to help figure out what I'm going to teach within intensive intervention. So let's go ahead and we're going to watch a brief video here. So this is one of our intensive intervention tutors. This is Steven, and he is working with Eric. And he's going to ask Eric some questions about fractions.
All right, Eric, today we're going to work on adding fractions, okay?
Okay.
All right, but we're going to focus on adding fractions with different denominators. All right. Can you think of 2 fractions with the same denominators?
1/4 and 3/4.
1/4 and 3/4. Good. So the bottom number or the denominator is the same, right?
Right.
So can you think of 2 fractions now with different denominators?
5/5 and 6/3.
6/3, 5/5 and 6/3. All right, good. But so when we add fractions with the same denominator, it's easy, right? So if we look at the fractions 3/7 and 2/7, we can just add the numerators, right? Or the top numbers.
Right.
Right. So what are the numerators here?
The numerators are 3/7 and 2/7.
So the numerator is the top number, right? So what's the top number in this one?
The numerator is 3, and the numerator for the other one is 2.
2, good. So, what is 3 plus 2?
5.
5, awesome. So we put a 5, and then the fraction bar, and then what's the denominator?
The denominator is a 7.
7, so the 7 just carries over into the answer, right?
Right.
But when we have fractions with denominators that are different, we have to take a couple of steps before we can add them, okay?
Okay.
All right, so let's look at the steps here that we have to take. So when we're adding fractions with different denominators, the first thing we do is we're gonna model the fractions, and then we're gonna find multiples of the denominators. The third thing is we determine the lowest common denominator. Next, we determine how many new sets of each fraction you need and make them. And then the last thing is you add.
Okay.
All right.
So what we see here is that this teacher is focusing on instruction related to addition of fractions with unlike denominators. And when designing this instruction, he's had to think about whether this student has knows earlier skills along the continuum of mathematics learning. So he has to think about, like, well, does this student know about addition and subtraction? Does the student know about different fraction concepts? Does the student know what the word denominator means and what the denominator represents? What about numerator? What about different fraction models? And we'll get to it in a later module. And maybe thinking about multiples, because that's going to help us with our unlike denominators. And in addition to these math skills, our teacher, Stephen, also has to think about whether our student knows how to read different questions. Are they understanding the language, both the oral language and the written language of mathematics? And does the student know how to follow directions? So there's a lot going on here. When we're thinking about teaching one concept, we have to think about everything that it comes before that concept and other skills that are important for the student to have. Now it's your turn to do workbook activity number 6. And in this activity, I want you to review this list of strengths and weaknesses of a student. And then think about what content is going to be important for this student in terms of intensive intervention, what foundational skills might be a part of intensive intervention, and how might some of those things need to be taught. Now, in this module, we've been talking about this part of intensive intervention, which is right here, our instructional platform. So this is where we have intervention, and it occurs frequently and with intensity. So here's our blue arrow to show us exactly where we've been. So if you've helped us learn throughout this entire module, we should be able to review this part 3 checklist. So this part was all about identifying mathematical content for intensive intervention and sequencing that content. So remember, you need to use a variety of assessments and sources to identify the content that's necessary for intensive intervention, and then use data and standards to appropriately sequence that instructional content.